people were dying. For the day, maybe you hear about 15, 20 people dying.
That was the day when I woke up and I cried for 3 hours. I was just like, you know, how can this be happening? And just felt so helpless and so determined to get involved.
The day we got to Roquel, the whole community, it was like they were all gathered in front of this house as if they were waiting for these two children to die. For the first time, the seriousness and the cruelty of Ebola really hit me.
Today, I ask the entire nation to mourn with the families of our national heroes, including Dr. Sheikh Umar Khan, who lost their lives battling the Ebola outbreak in our country.
On the 29th of July, 2014, Sierra Leone's President Ernest Nkrumah declared a state of emergency in the nation after one of the few doctors in Sierra Leone with extensive experience in hemorrhagic fevers, Dr. Sheikh Umar Khan, died from the Ebola virus. It was already 2 months since the first Ebola death was reported in Sierra Leone, and it marked a turning point in the crisis as a few weeks later, the World Health Organization declared Ebola an international public health emergency. With a death rate as high as 80%, the outbreak had become the worst public health crisis in Sierra Leone's history. At the Kenema Government Hospital in the eastern part of the country, Dr. Khan had started treating the early Ebola cases with a few other Sierra Leonean doctors back in May. But even with the help of Doctors Without Borders, it was clear that Sierra Leone was completely unprepared for the Ebola outbreak. The prime culprit was the practice of unsafe funeral rituals in which bodies were handled and washed before burial. In fact, that turned out to be the reason for the initial spread of the disease from the Kailaun district in northeastern Sierra Leone throughout the rest of the country.
One of the traditional healers was a woman who went to Guinea and came back. Of course, she never knew she was infected. And when she died, of course, as you may know yourself, that women participated in a burial. So that was why at the initial stage, more women were infected than men.
Ilule we say we no be understand body say. Just meet we from this mami we get this house. And from now we really understand say Ebola again at this country. But we no be know. That thing we no be understand. We fit say na other thing. So we say we see people that we run away. We no be know.
When people became ill in Kailaun, the only place where they can get proper medical attention was in Kenema, so they had to move. And most of these were in the homes of their relatives. They never reported to the facility in the early stages. So in fact, that was why in the Kenema district, Kenema town was mostly affected because it was the major town and people moved from Kailaun to Kenema.
The incidents in the Kailaun district became a template for the spread of the virus in other parts of the country. By the time doctors, nurses, and other caregivers started succumbing to the disease, the spread of rumors, misinformation, and panic had far outpaced government efforts at stemming the tide of the outbreak. Rumors that Ebola had no cure, inadequate care at treatment centers, combined with television images of medical personnel in yellow and blue protective gear burying bodies in unmarked graves, made it even more difficult to convince people to report symptoms and illness. Scores of people would hide their sick at home and try to treat them there, or if forced to go to quarantined areas and treatment centers, escape back to their villages.
In Canada, the mortuary, they can't take really stab them because we don't do that Mao before. So now we are the first people that we can contact. We go train from Kenema, we come. But the first Ebola case we'll get here, we'll go for go bury in our kingdom. It not be easy for we. Because the people them by them, they be the fear. They be the afraid that even they throw stone at we, they say they don't allow them to go bury any positive case. Until after that barrier, we go meet the minister, we explain, tell them, say, well now, this kind of virus here, we don't come. We need for get security with we. But it not be really easy. Any side where they pass, people they holler away. Ebola, Ebola. Even when they pass to Motoka, they go back, people they holler away. But we still take the courage because we be the work for country.
In August 2014, the number of confirmed cases of Ebola rose steadily throughout the country. The statistics were horrifying and the epidemic appeared out of control. But even as Sierra Leone's weak health infrastructure crumbled under the weight of the Ebola onslaught, efforts by the government, concerned citizens and other organizations were stepped up considerably. Handshaking and casual body contact were discouraged. Veronica buckets became a staple in every home, office and neighborhood. Infrared thermometers were used liberally everywhere. The government ordered the creation of more trained burial teams, psychosocial counseling for survivors, surveillance teams, the allocation of land for impromptu isolation and treatment centers, and allocation of cemeteries for safe burial of Ebola victims.
We have divided the various Western area into zones.
The Ebola Emergency Operations Center had a hotline, 117, for emergency calls when a person was sick. But a common practice was to wash the dead and dress them up for burial before calling for help. The hotline soon became overwhelmed and couldn't respond fast enough to the calls for burial or collection of sick people. People died in their homes awaiting transfer to treatment centers, and burial teams sometimes took days to collect dead bodies. Soon, the military was asked to take over the Ebola Command Center, and it became part of the National Ebola Response Center. Identification, quarantining, and contact tracing were stepped up and intensified.
We also took up the responsibility to secure health facilities, because initially, when people turn up at the health facilities and Ebola tests are conducted on them, they tend to escape from those hospitals. They hide themselves here and there. So it was decided that the military also secure health facilities, clinics, so that in case there are Ebola cases in those places, those people can be kept intact instead of allowing them to go out into the community and spread the virus more and more.
Finally, the president ordered a 3-day lockdown throughout the country from the 18th to the 21st of September 2014. Strictly enforced by the military, no one was allowed to leave his or her premises. When it was over, the lockdown revealed an explosion of new cases in 3 more districts and a significant increase in the western area, including the capital, Freetown.
During the lockdown, Boku people then be dying at the houses then. Who be they pass and collect the body then from house to house. During the lockdown then, so many houses then be the way sick people then be they, where then be they hide them. But during the lockdown now, because people will go check house to house checking, so then they present the people that were sick from the various houses. So the work for we during the lockdown will be very tedious, because at 24 hours will be the work for the day.
Massive international support began pouring into the country. But Sierra Leoneans at home and everywhere in the diaspora were not just sitting still.
I came from Lonsar, originally from Lonsar, and I was worried about it. And I said, well, I want to do something, but I don't have money. Then they said, well, we can help. What do you want? I said, I want a burial van, a van for burial. Because at that time, when somebody died in Lonsar, the burial team live in Port Loko. They have, every night, they have to go to Port Loko. The ambulance stays there, and in the morning, they don't start the burial till 12.
With the help of the Attorney General and other concerned citizens, Haja Aisha Darami Kabir went to work in Lonsar, securing burial vans, training healthcare workers and traditional birth attendants, and visiting quarantine homes to check people's temperatures and provide other forms of medical assistance.
At the time when I went to Lonsar, we had 62 quarantine houses, and we visit them every day. Every day, those 62 houses were visited every day, and every individual in that house has a temperature taken. We were the first to give them a full quota. All the things that makes a good meal, we used to give those to the quarantine houses. And of course, that makes a lot of difference, because these people were well fed.
An initial shortage of treatment centers and medical staff also contributed to the increase in the death rate from Ebola. So community care centers were first tried in the Port Loko district, where several schools were converted into isolation and treatment centers. Ordinary citizens were asked to volunteer as caregivers and were trained in the use of personal protective equipment and basic care of patients.
We came together, we called all the health workers in the Marampa chiefdom, and we worked the stakeholders, we started doing training, doing ordinary hygiene and all the rest of it. The challenge was that we did not have where to take them. At that time, we did not have a holding center in any of the districts apart from Kenema and Pujon. WHO did not fix their attention into providing holding centers, treatment centers.
So then, thing where we drink, like the thing where we take.
Dr. Sonia Spencer had experience working in crisis-stricken areas of other countries and felt compelled to offer assistance in her own hometown.
I thought water will be one of the good things to give. ORS was specifically chosen because the hotline, the people at the emergency center, or whatever it's called, the response center, do not respond immediately. And sometimes people start vomiting or they have diarrhea which goes on for days. And we know that by vomiting or even through frequent stools, they tend to lose a lot of salts. So giving ORS is a way of putting back the salts that they lose through the vomit or the diarrhea.
And so began Drinks on Wheels, a program that took Dr. Spencer and her team to the most critical Ebola hotspots, providing people in quarantine homes with water, soap, plastic bags to use as gloves, and oral rehydration solution.
During the talk with the quarantine people, I specifically mentioned that they are not to use it for bathing, but they should use it for washing their hands. Okay. And then plastic bags, which they use as improvised gloves, because some of them have become infected by using their bare hands to care for the sick. And we want them to know that they have to protect themselves to stop the spread of this virus, especially in their compounds.
In order for us to stop Ebola, the most single important thing that you need to do is to isolate the sick. The disease spreads by contact with the sick. If the sick has no contact, then you are able to contain it and stop the spread. So very importantly is making sure you have infrastructure to enable that isolation to happen.
Now let's get more now on the fight against Ebola and what more needs to be done to get it under control. Joining me here in the studio, Yvonne Akisoya, co-founder of the Sierra Leone War Trust for Children.
Sierra Leoneans abroad, just like those at home, were galvanized into action to support the effort in their country. Yvonne Akisoya was chairperson of the Sierra Leone War Trust in England, and she started making calls to raise funds so their non-profit could effectively engage with needy communities in the Ebola-affected areas in the country. Together with her sister Trudy, they started delivering much-needed provisions to the affected communities.
We started off by providing a number of Veronica buckets. These are the buckets with the nozzles, and chlorine to market women and to the mayor of Freetown in conjunction with Edward Davis Associates. We have, in conjunction with Mr. Oluni Robin Coker, provided 1,000 overcoats to Okada drivers. And more recently, we've been working with the Sierra Leone Medical Association, Medical and Dental Association, SLMDA, to provide thermometers, gloves, protective gear to doctors who are in the private sector and who have kept their clinics and surgeries open despite the emergent situation.
In September, as the numbers began to increase and MSF were out very much in public calling for a military response, calling for more engagement in the international community, I got involved with writing a petition with MSF support to the UK government to call for them to do more. We did have an outcome in early September when the UK government announced they were going to build 700 beds and they were going to also facilitate the deployment of UK NHS workers, healthcare workers from the UK to come to Sierra Leone.
Their efforts did not stop at fundraising and petitions. They needed to rally a more critical mass of volunteers from the Sierra Leone diaspora healthcare community. For that, they got help from DFID, the UK's Department for International Development.
One of the key things was you were being asked to volunteer, but you weren't being asked to leave your job. You know, your job would be backfilled. This was an arrangement that the UK government was going to make with your employer.
But perhaps the most common concern for volunteers was medical care, insurance, and a guarantee of medical evacuation, given the very deadly nature of the Ebola virus disease.
We went through a sort of Q&A of what we felt people needed to do. And as a result of that, we produced material, both electronically and in hard copy, which we distributed, you know, to schools, to hospitals where people were working, to supermarkets, to community centres. From about the middle of September, I started to attend all of DFID's weekly meetings, planning this staffing response. And secondly, off our own back and off our own initiative, we decided to run a series of roadshows across the country so that people weren't sitting in their homes and having to make what is actually a very difficult decision about taking the risk of coming out and fighting Ebola in a healthcare worker capacity.
A roadshow is being held by a West Midlands charity later today to appeal for more volunteers to help tackle the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. Nearly 5,000 people have died from the disease so far. The event at Birmingham University is being hosted by the Sierra Leone War Trust for Children.
We set up these panels, which consisted of the main employers, so at the time Save the Children, but also GOAL, Public Health England, UK Med, who were taking the responsibility for actually the recruitment process of these UK healthcare professionals. And then MSF, a doctor who had recently come from Sierra Leone, was, you know, attended these either by Skype or in person, depending on where it was, and could just give first-hand experience of what they'd been through, what the challenges were, and really give people an opportunity to engage with that.
The response from the Sierra Leonean diaspora was very encouraging. Primetime news coverage of their efforts helped to increase awareness of the volunteer drive, and soon not only diaspora Sierra Leoneans, but also British nationals were packing their bags to lend their support.
Birmingham council worker Lynette Adjaye's childhood friend Sarata is in Freetown coordinating nurses. She's also caring directly for people with Ebola.
They are totally and utterly emaciated. You could literally pick their bones off the floor. They can't speak. They have the obvious signs and symptoms of a person who's suffered from Ebola.
As help poured in for the sick and dying, more individuals and groups were showing concern about the ones being left behind. Children whose parents had succumbed to the virus were growing in number and needed to be sheltered and cared for. Sophie Johnson first rallied her family, then later got the support of Zonta International to gather and ship supplies from the UK to Sierra Leone.
We looked at all the different groups and what they were doing, and everybody's participating and trying to help towards this Ebola. And one of the areas that stood out were the survivors. You know, survivors, at the point of it, as we all know, they lose everything. And to have to go through that journey, go through that loss, bereavement, stress, and then once you survive that, to then feel, how do I start back out in the world and the society again? We felt that would be where we would focus our food appeal. So we put hampers together and we have clothes, primarily for children, the orphan children, because that's a great passion of Zonta, to look after the well-being of the children of Sierra Leone.
Today, all the discharges put together, now 444.
Beginning in October 2014, stories of survival and recovery started filtering through like rays of sunlight over a dark horizon. Here at the Hastings Treatment Center, also known as PTS1, medical coordinator Dr. Santigi Sise was giving out exit packages and discharge certificates to individuals that had recovered from the Ebola virus disease. The center at Hastings had been constructed prior to the three-day lockdown in mid-September in response to an acute shortage of available beds for the sick. On the insistence of the Deputy Minister of Health, the center was staffed exclusively with Sierra Leonean doctors and other health professionals, many from the military hospital in Freetown. The survival rate from the Ebola virus disease at this time was a mere 20%.
Initially, it was intended to be run as a holding center, but with discussions with the Minister of Health, we came to an agreement that we will convert into a treatment center. Because before this time, all the treatment centers, them, non-Sierra Leonean run them. So it was like the first Sierra Leonean run treatment center.
Very soon, the mortality rate in Hastings started to drop, leading to increasing numbers of discharged patients.
These are people that were diagnosed with Ebola viral diseases, and they were admitted to the treatment center. They went through treatment management, and today, after their retest, they have converted negative. So we're going to discharge them. They will show it to their community that they are now Ebola free, and they don't pose any threat to their community. Because one thing we've noticed is that when they go back to their communities, they are like stigmatized. But we think with these certificates, I mean, they should be able to give some kind of comfort to their communities for them to be accepted and integrated again.
3 months after the Hastings Treatment Center was opened, the survival rate was proving significantly higher than at other centers in the country. Out of more than 640 patients admitted, about 442 survivors were discharged from the facility. By this time, China, the UK and Cuba, among other nations, had made notable contributions to the Ebola effort, building clinics and providing beds for treatment centers. So the success of the Sierra Leonean-staffed Hastings Treatment Center became that beacon of hope in a country whose people for months had only known the deepening gloom of a deadly epidemic.
For us, our main treatment protocol, in fact, the first phase is we do intravenous injections and intramuscular injections. We replace the fluids that is lost by the patient. So by doing so, we've seen that we are able to get these people to survive. So I think basically that's the difference. We go into the vein, we give intramuscular injections, and we go close to the patient, we feed them. If they're not able to feed themselves, we even bathe them if they're not able to bathe themselves. So I think that extra mile that we go in is actually responsible for the success.
That type of care made a survivor out of Kadiatou Sissé, orphaned when her parents fell ill with Ebola and died. She was taken to the St. George Foundation, an interim care center that functioned as an orphanage to be cared for by more volunteer Sierra Leoneans. But for Wara, a young mother with Ebola, it was quite a different story. When she was delivered to the center with her baby daughter, she was seriously ill, much worse than her child.
Wara, they vomit continuously, frequent stool weakness. We get for the gear and drip, we get for the monitor, the drip. So now they left and no more go out. For the go out nine time, where one group come, another group go out. Now so we do for Wara.
For more than a week, Wara's condition failed to improve. But for an instant, she seemed to stabilize.
They all make 8 and 9 days, they look better small. So the nurse will go for go empty this drip or the monitor. It just see suddenly while in condition change. While in breathing stop, while I begin fet by itself, now the nurse raise alarm, call. Nurses, doctor on the app. So we get for a wash, go inside with the nurses now, fall to doctors, they will go inside. But now doctor, now they certify, now they check if the patients, they are alive or not. So doctor begin for check this patient. In order to be really, in order to be doctor check them with the stethoscope, they call with the nurses for cross check. We cross check and there was no breathing.
The last glimmer of hope for Wara's survival seemed like it was gone. Following protocol, the burial team was called in to spray the body and prepared for transport out of the treatment center. And then, with all eyes on the scene, the unbelievable happened.
We team up there, the spray, mass spray Wara. It's where in the hospital, it's not the bagel. Because for know if he die or not, it's spraying up to his nose, no sneeze. Now, when they don't put inside the bag, when they don't zip them, when they spray, Now we are sneeze. That's not God in wonders. We don't really know what it happened. It sneezes, we all get for joy. Allah, hey, praise God, praise God. Now tell us, I said, this is not the wonders of God. And we get for unzip our back, we clean them up, we sit and down, we get our food. Because now end it through, we will feed you. We get our food, we take care of our, we are not sick here. From that day now, we are okay.
Actually, I think she is a miracle child. By the help of God, she woke up from her unconsciousness, and she was able to withstand the virus, and we did a test again and she was negative, and after a few days she was discharged home, and as I speak to you, she is comfortably living with her family. It was a miracle, really.
The Pekin self survived, our two distant together. But while in case was so serious, past the Pekin. But the Pekin self survived, our two distant the same day. It was so wonderful. God in wonders, the day self we distant. We're so happy for see while at distant. Because if we don't die, he rise up again. It was God in wonders.
Despite the successes of the Hastings Treatment Center, and even as more treatment facilities sprang up around the region and the country, the Ebola virus remained stubbornly difficult to control. As 2014 drew to a close, the number of reported Ebola infections rose steadily, especially in the western area and the capital, Freetown. The best efforts at raising awareness of the dangers of the disease were still yielding spotty results as people continued to touch and wash dead bodies, hide their sick relatives, or attempt to treat them at home. Cultural and religious funeral traditions came into sharp conflict with the advice of health experts, and there was continued resistance to authorities doing contact tracing and those picking up the sick from affected communities. The government then mandated all deaths, regardless of whether they were caused by Ebola, to be handled by the Ebola burial teams. Religious leaders were assured that safe and dignified burials would be accorded to all persons.
Before this time, people then they take body then at various funeral home, then they allow family member, relative, then they beg. But since Ebola can go messed up everything, everything be the now the burial team be in charge of all burials.
These led to the thinking of, you know, doing this burial together with community people, involving them, allowing them to also be part of the burial process, except that they don't touch the corpse. We are allowed to do the burial for them, but we allow them to witness the burial process, and we also encourage them to say they are normal. Prayers and some who carry out some traditional practices in a way of honoring their dead.
Still, by the close of November 2014, about half of the Ebola cases in Sierra Leone were identified in the western area, the result of a stubborn resistance by local people to heed the advice of health professionals. As some citizens continued hiding their dead, washing bodies and performing secret burials at night, the need for a more permanent solution turned paramount. Yvonne Akisoya had taken over planning at the National Ebola Response Center.
It felt as though the Western area was completely out of control and getting worse by the day. With 50% of the cases coming from Western area, we had to develop a plan.
That plan was called the Western Area Surge. Travel was restricted between all districts in the country, and mandatory house-to-house searches for the sick were resumed with an increased urgency. In support of it, the government banned all Christmas celebrations and holiday activities.
It was a surge on two levels. It was a surge on the supply side, in terms of the infrastructure there to fight the disease. The other side of that is actually engaging with communities so that those who are sick are identified and can be isolated.
So the staff at the National Ebola Response Center quickly went to work projecting and planning for a month-long assault on the rising number of infected cases. Provisions were made to bolster the number of beds for treatment centers, processing labs, ambulances, contact tracers, and community monitors. By the end of the month, the number of beds had almost doubled. The number of labs had gone from 2 to 6, processing 408 samples a day. The number of ambulances and contact tracers was essentially doubled, and about 300 community monitors were brought in to assist the contact tracers.
Having surged the supply, what we did on the demand side was working with the ward councillors, working with NGO, local NGOs such as the Bread for Life Consortium, working with the SMAC Consortium, the international NGOs. There was active case finding. Door to door. It wasn't a lockdown, as we all know, but we did have a heightened engagement with the general public. There were media campaigns, there was simultaneous broadcasts on television and on radio, and the results were significant and remarkable.
So significant that it caught the attention of international health organizations and encouraged the National Ebola Response Center to dig even deeper.
Through that effort, we were able to bring out and isolate many more people than would otherwise have happened. And it was with the kind of feedback that we got from that. Of course, there were challenges, there were pockets of resistance, which is why we're now doing Western Area Search 2, which is a different feel. In terms of the supply side, we're there. We've surged, the beds are there, the labs are there. What we're now working on is deepened community engagement, strengthening surveillance, and intensifying our contact tracing.
At the same time as these measures were being taken, efforts were made by others to wage the battle on new fronts. Too many of Sierra Leone's hardest working doctors had lost their lives in the fight against Ebola, but there were still quite a few taking valiant strides to curb the outbreak. Their attempts ranged from encouraging government to speed up clinical trials of drugs and vaccines to advocating alternative types of therapy. In the Western area, where the fight against exploding infected cases had intensified, expectations rose and fell along with emotions as some people survived and others succumbed. When one of the most respected medical doctors in the country, Dr. Willoughby, became infected with Ebola virus, a new drug that had proved effective in Liberia was brought in. As they prepared to try it on the good doctor, another woman who had got infected was admitted to a new treatment facility. Mrs. Junietta McCauley runs a funeral home in central Freetown and realized she had gotten infected after her husband died from the virus. Doctors decided to administer ZMAB, a clone of the experimental drug ZMAP that was about to be tried on Dr. Willoughby.
That was Saturday the 20th. By the 22nd, I was better. I think because of the blood plasma that was transfused, that started eating up the Ebola virus. And by the time I got to emergency, I could eat, not a lot, but I could eat. And that made them feel better. After the ZMAP, 2 days after, all of a sudden I realized I wasn't having diarrhea.
Dr. Willoughby's condition had deteriorated to such an extent that by the time the drug was ready, he had passed away.
The temperature is the same as outside.
Dr. Kojo Kiru, another Sierra Leonean doctor, decided to take advantage of an offer from an old acquaintance. It was an offer to try out an alternative type of therapy called ozone therapy.
We were going to treat every Ebola patient free of charge. We were going to bear the cost. I was going to bear the local cost, and the Americans were going to support me with supplies to do that. There are lots of local costs involved, including personnel, that I was going to put in so that the patients would not have to pay a single cent.
But his quixotic efforts ran into procedural and other problems that put a halt to his plans.
If an experimental intervention is to be done, we need to know what you want to do. Not just about the safety of the product, but how the product is going to be administered. Various groups have tried to introduce various interventions single-handedly without going through the regulatory and legislative requirements. In this country, there is a fixed and set mechanism of introducing experimental products.
We went to State House. From State House, we were given permission by the government, and it was done by the chief medical officer, Dr. Brian Makagbo, on the 22nd of October, when we were called by Professor Monty Jones.
I mean, we don't know if ozone works. We would love it to work. But if you want to introduce an experimental intervention into a healthcare system, it must be done in a controlled and scientific way so that the data, the lessons learned from the data that is generated, could be used for future generations. And this is exactly the problem we've had.
They've been doing this kind of thing for over 30 years. In the United States, in Cuba, in Germany, in all over the world. In fact, ozone is used even out of the body. It is used in all major purification systems in the world. Water purification systems. You cannot purify water with anything else other than ozone. So we went to the Hastings Center, which we asked them for us to go to rather than the others, because this was a purely run Sierra Leonean center, and this is a pure Sierra Leonean venture, just to show the world what needs to be done, not only with Ebola, but any other scourge.
Dr. Kerou was not alone in seeking out new and alternative medicines and therapies. At the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Dr. Alhaji Injai, a biologist from Sierra Leone, is conducting research on infected and recovered people in the affected areas and collaborating with scientists from the University of Sierra Leone. The idea is to investigate the interactions between the virus and infected persons to try to carve out a path to an effective vaccine. But Dr. Injai and his colleagues are also concerned about those that survive.
For those who survived the Ebola, they may have some adverse event or some events on them, like some lethal effects, some side effects that are, you know, that include things like blindness, and we don't know all the other side effects. So we want to track people who survived the Ebola for like a period of a year or two, and then we can basically understand what are all of the issues from a medical perspective and other issues that are associated with people who survive the Ebola virus.
In Sierra Leone, there are now well over 3,000 survivors of the Ebola virus disease, and indeed, some have suffered from the debilitating effects of the infection's journey through their bodies. Blindness, deafness, and wobbly limbs are some of the after effects survivors have had to suffer. There is a number of charitable organizations run by Sierra Leoneans that have offered to provide care not just for the infected, but also for survivors of this scourge. Remember Kadiatu Sise, one of the survivors who was discharged from the Hastings Treatment Center and taken to the St. George's Orphanage? Her caretakers noticed she wasn't very agile. She had cramps and had trouble walking. With the help of the Martha Logan Thomas Society, they set her up with a physical therapist at the military hospital in Freetown and supported her care and recovery. Another survivor, Aminata Kagbo, a young 23-year-old woman who was also treated at Hastings, was also orphaned after her mother died from Ebola. The Sierra Leone War Trust took up her cause and is supporting her in her efforts to further her education. Indeed, the Ebola outbreak caused the education sector to take a major hit as schools and colleges all over the country shut down. But other areas suffered heavily too. Retail businesses and bank branches closed down and laid off workers, especially in the interior, while other companies suspended operations indefinitely. The government was forced to take emergency measures in order to slow the downward slide of the economy. A number of international airlines cancelled their flight routes to and from Sierra Leone, made worse by embassies closing and refusing to grant new visas to Sierra Leone nationals. By the time the two major mining companies essentially shut down, the tourism industry was on the brink of collapse.
It's really important for us to be able to get these things going.
Wilben Short is directing the building of a new Hilton Hotel in Western Freetown. His company, IDEA UK, was one of the few that stuck it out in the face of the widening Ebola epidemic.
We continued to work at full speed right till around mid-September. By early October, they were actually continuing to work on-site by using Sierra Leonean subcontractors. And so the work continued, and the construction of the ancillary buildings, the excavation, were all done using local labor.
By the turn of the year, the country as a whole started to see a significant decrease in numbers of infected cases. the National Ebola Response Center embarked on a second phase of action for the western area and the capital. Ms. Aki Sawyer and other Sierra Leone officials also met with their counterparts from Guinea and Liberia in February 2015 to work out sub-regional plans to curb the cross-border risks posed by the epidemic.
Where we were in the outbreak, we had developed the district plans, and clearly this is a district-led response. What goes on at the district level is critical, but at the same time, it's also important for there to be a national cohesion. There needs to be one place where everything is pulled together, and there needs to be one place where we've documented and are cognizant of everything our partners are doing as well.
As the country continues to move towards that elusive target of zero reported cases, everyday hardworking and courageous Sierra Leoneans are still striving very hard to eliminate the scourge once and for all. A much wider and more effective net has been cast, one that puts a sharpened focus on information sharing and pinpointing cases and contacts. Operations at the former Ebola Command Center have been tightened and streamlined, and successful local strategies are being replicated in other troublesome district areas.
Quarantine officers are all outside in the field. I was talking to them earlier today. They are going out. Contact tracers are all in the field as well, doing their normal contact tracing work. And then surveillance officers, of course, all have gone out in the field. They are doing their work in the field and then finding the cases, responding to alerts, doing active surveillance as well.
With most areas of the country consistently reporting zero cases, the risk remains in the border areas with the other affected countries, Guinea and Liberia. But it is now clear that some of the most crucial work that has to be done will need to be done by community members.
You've got people whose houses, the front door is in Sierra Leone, the back door is in Guinea. You know, you have people who, they live in Sierra Leone, but their farm, it's like, look, my farm daddy, just across the river, you know, and it's in Guinea. So the communities are very closely intertwined, they're all social speaking, and they're family. So stopping cross-border movement is very difficult. So what we need to do is empower the communities to ensure that they actually understand, perhaps most important, and the lesson that we learn from other countries who have seen Ebola time and time again, Uganda being a case in point, is that the resilience that we're looking for has to be at a community level. The communities need to really have us invest in them, the skills and the capacity to be able to identify, or not necessarily identify, because that may be too much to ask, but to actually have systems in place where if disease is seen, it is reported, and there's an opportunity for the health professionals to quickly come and assess whether this is in fact Ebola.
The national response to the Ebola virus disease has undoubtedly been fraught with problems and setbacks, but the tireless work of a host of native sons and daughters with the assistance of international health and donor agencies has almost put an end to these trying times. Experts realize that sustaining the positive results is the next leap forward, but the revitalization of the education, commerce, and tourism sectors are also critical to the economic recovery of Sierra Leone. Once again, efforts towards that end are being spearheaded by Sierra Leoneans themselves.
It's been a huge effort, huge team effort, both from the NERC, Ministry of Health colleagues, development partners, but I think the real heroes continue to be those young men and women and older men and women all over the country, in the districts, in the ECTs, in the units, in the command centers, the ambulance drivers, the swabbers, you know, the guys who I speak to all the time. You've got these heroes who are facing still lots of, you know, challenges in just getting the job done. And I really thank God for the people who have stood up in this response and made us proud to be Sierra Leonean.
A lot is up to us as to how we Sierra Leoneans promote our country Sierra Leone again. There are lots of perceptions abroad about Ebola and the impact that it's had, but especially in my own industry, you know, Sierra Leone pre-Ebola and post-Ebola is as beautiful as it's always been. The economy will pick up again and people will start coming.
We have to learn some lessons. We need to put things in place so that, you know, there's a dividend from this. Something needs to be the silver lining behind this cloud. And there are a number of things where that could happen.
the strengthening of the healthcare system would be a great one, and the onus is on the Ministry of Health to do that because NERC won't be around. You know, the possibility of there being an ambulance service, a national ambulance service, is another one. And of course, like I said before, investment at community level, so that we actually have in place proper community systems, IDSR, integrated disease surveillance response systems, which are becoming standard across Africa, but which we've been, as a country, a little bit slow to sort of take up and you know, sort of go forward with. That's now critical, absolutely critical, to ensure that we don't get to this place again.
That place, where over 8,500 people were infected with the Ebola virus disease, will indeed become a distant memory on the landscape of Sierra Leone's history, but will nevertheless remind us of a time when the resilience of a people remained strong and proud in the face of a most deadly epidemic. Most encouraging of all is that the people can now hold their heads up and say, "Welcome back to Sierra Leone. We are happy to have you."
This is a true talk from the heart, because this thing don't wanna win, and that make Attila man dangerous. Don't step up, for you know these vibes. Take man,
Ebola,
now,
Ebola,
right now,
that's a better Komoya,
today,
Ebola,
back,
Ebola,
that's alone,
we go pull and Komoya,
yes,
Ebola,
now,
Ebola,
today,
we go better Komoya.
Now you business to church and your mugs and any side where you day. But if you get chlorine set, you can use them. If you not get them, no worry at all. Soap and clean water, even get all. Then safety kill the virus. Body to body contact, you know. You can contact Ebola through that. Ebola know the big cold. You know I know who that you be. If you there for government, you know I know. You oppose government, you know I know.
Join and for fetch this Ebola sick. Salona, we all you.